Well, hello and welcome to today's Bible reading and devotional time. This is for Thursday, July the 4th, 2024. Happy Independence Day to my fellow Americans, to Richard Nixon, my fellow Americans. Anyway, Rich Little's got nothing to worry about coming from me. But today is day 82 of our 90 days reading through the gospel and the letters of John. We are in 1 John chapter 2 today, and I'm trying to decide what to do with, eight more days, right, if I did the math right. Trying to decide what to do after this one. I'm leaning towards doing a read-through of Luke and Acts, since Acts is kind of the sequel. And if anybody's got any opinions on anything, leave them in the comment section below, and I will give them consideration. So now let's look at our text. For 1 John, okay, it's up there on the monitor. And I got to remember, this is getting towards the end of John's life, the end of the first century. John was probably written around 90 AD, the three letters in the Gospels. Yeah, they could have been in Revelation. They could have been written earlier, and I tend to lean towards earlier dates for all the New Testament documents, with the possible exception of Revelation. Because none of them mentioned the destruction of Jerusalem. Pretty significant event to the Jews, and there would be, some record of it somewhere if they were written after the destruction. Matthew mentions it, chapter 25 and 6, as sort of a prophetic, or 24 and 5, as sort of a prophetic. It's going to happen when you see Jerusalem surrounded by armies and that kind of thing. So it was coming, and I believe that was necessary to the destruction of the temple, necessary to show the complete break with the old covenant, and now we're in the new covenant. So with all that out of the way, let's look at our text. Now in these verses, John's going to talk to youth, young people. A little bit of subjectivity there as to what defines young, I guess. But young people, you know, always need guidance. And it's the funny thing that as I get older and I look back, you know, when I was in my 20s, I thought, that I was smart, that I was grown up. Then I'd hit 30 and I was, you know, what was I thinking? I wasn't grown up at 20. Then come into my 40s and I think, man, at 30, what an immature little kid I was. And then into my 50s, I thought I was mature at 40. What was I thinking? And so it just seems we look back on periods of our life and when we thought we were grown up. And it's probably because now I've got more life experiences and made some more mistakes along the way and that sort of thing. But we have to help young people be prepared. Now, if you're a Christian, you've really got your work cut out for you. I should say we have our work cut out for us as far as raising our children. Our children growing up, of course, they like to think they've got all the answers. As I was saying earlier, at 18, 19, 20, you think you're grown up. And legally, yes, you are now responsible for yourself once you get up to 18. But you are still not mentally, emotionally, or spiritually mature. Really, physically, you're probably not even mature. There's still some growing going on. But the older men need to be teaching younger men certain things, and the older women need to be teaching the younger women certain things. Now, this nonsense about toxic masculinity needs to go. Okay, men are men, women are women. We are programmed differently. Nick Freitas, is it Freitas? He's a member of the Virginia House of Delegates. Former Army Special Forces, he's done a lot of videos about it, how he's got at least one son and one daughter. I don't know if he's got any other kids or not, but how he's raised them and how he's taught his son about the man's role and taught his daughter about the woman's role, what she should look for in a man. And I'll tell you right now, we have this sort of running gag about boyfriend. My daughter is only 10, but I'm going to be honest. There's a lot of men out there that are not worthy of her, that if they come around, they're leaving. Dad is not going to allow them to stay around. Men need to be teaching their sons to treat women correctly, the courtesies that men need to do, and that sort of thing. And the young people of a congregation, we have to remember, are the future. And you go into a congregation and all you see are bald heads and white hair over here and gray hairs over here, and there's no babies crying. That's not a good sign. We visited a church once. Amelia was maybe 6 months old. And we got there. The preacher hadn't arrived yet. And there were some in the auditorium. There were some women there. We were talking to them. And they said, now, when Brother so-and-so, I forget his name, but when Brother so-and-so gets here, if your baby cries, they said, do not take her out. He will call you on it if you do. A few minutes later, preacher comes in and we're talking to him. And he says, now, if your daughter starts to cry, he said, do not take her out. Yeah, I can preach louder than she can cry. I thought that's a novel way of looking at it, because most people immediately remove the child. That's what we always did. And it used to really bother me when a baby was crying, and after 20 or 30 minutes, I can still hear the baby crying. It's a distraction. But then I got to thinking about it. That's actually a good sign to hear that baby cry, because that says the church has a future if you've got a couple of crying babies. So I tell women and men, you know, you bring in your infant, they start crying. I tell them the same thing. I'll preach louder. I got, you know, my sound man back there. He can turn up the sound louder and we can blast them right out. So don't worry about taking them out. Now, if you think you need to, go ahead. Use your own good judgment, but don't do it on my account. Okay, so parents, men especially, we need to step up our game. We need to get more involved in our children's lives. They are not capable of raising themselves. Many parents seem to have done just that. They abdicated their responsibilities and kind of left it to the schools. I was a paraprofessional in a school, and the teacher I worked for called a parent and said, I got a problem with your son, and he was out of control. The parent said, well, what the F fill in the blank do you want me to do about it? He's your problem while he's there. Well, let's see, that kid, that's been about 4, maybe 5 years ago. That kid was a third grader then, so he's about to graduate, if he's even still in school, about to graduate. And that's assuming he hasn't gotten in trouble with the law, because given his mother's attitude, and there, he wasn't the only one in the school, that kid's headed for trouble. He doesn't have a father, then anyway, didn't have a father figure in his life. So now I'm kind of taking a lot of time here, but I cannot emphasize enough the need that parents need to start reasserting our authority. The schools are not the parent. The government is not the parent. We need to start reasserting our authority, standing up to the nonsense that's going on in the schools, letting boys into the girls' locker room because they think they're women. Not ixnay on that. And we need to start being parents again. No, you are not going to go down this road. You're going to go down this road. Okay, I'm the parent. I'm not their friend. I'm not their peer. I'm not their buddy. Okay, I'm not just hanging. Well, you know, we might occasionally go to a movie or something, kind of hang together. But I'm the parent. It's just like in the military. I'm the commanding officer. She's the subordinate. Like it or not, that's the way it is. Deal with it. Anyway, on with our reading now. Verse 12, I write to you, little children, because your sins are forgiven and you are forgiven you for his name's sake. I write to you, fathers, because you have known him who is from the beginning. I write to you, young men, because you have overcome the wicked one. I write to you, little children, because you have known the Father, and I have written to you, fathers, because you have known him who is from the beginning. I have written to you, young men, because you are strong and the word of God abides in you. And you have overcome the wicked one. Do not love the world nor the things of the world. Okay, he's talking about the attitudes of the world, the ideas, the worldview. He's not talking about the people. If anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life is not of the Father, but is of the world. And the world is passing away in the lust of it, but he who does the will of God abides forever. Little children, it is the last hour. So we've been in the last day since the first century. Okay, so when the premillennialists, I don't even know if Hal Lindsey's still alive, but if 1948 Israel became a state, that's when the last day started. Wrong answer. John here says we are in the last day, or they were in the last days even back then. As you have heard that the Antichrist is coming, even now many Antichrists have come, by which we know that this is the last hour. They went out from us, but they were not of us. For if they had been of us, they would have continued with us. But they went out that they might be made manifest that none of them were of us. But you have an anointing from the Holy One, and you know all things. I have not written to you because you do not know the truth, but because you know it, and that no lie is of the truth. Who is a liar but he who denies that Jesus is the Christ? He is Antichrist, who denies the Father and the Son. Whoever denies the Son does not have the Father either. He who acknowledges the Son has the Father also. Okay, so let's go over here now and to the PowerPoint. Let's have a look at verse 14 here that he says, I have written to you, young men, that because you are strong and the word of God abides in you and you have overcome the wicked one. Now, temptation is going to come in life, and it can be overcome. Some people will have no problem with certain sins overcoming them. Other sins you're going to struggle with. 1 Corinthians chapter 6 and Galatians 5 show works of the flesh and people who won't inherit the kingdom of God and the various sins. And some of those sins are, for instance, alcoholism, drunkenness. Some people struggle with that all their life. Some people struggle with various other kinds of addiction, sexual sins, homosexuality, things like that. Some people can walk away and never look back. Others are going to struggle. Okay, but temptation can be overcome. And here's one example is Joseph from Genesis 39, when he encountered trouble because of Potiphar's wife. When she decided he was a nice-looking young man, he's muscular, he's strong. Yeah, I think I'd like to see if I can score with him, put it in kind of modern terms. At least that's what we would have said when I was a kid. She's trying to entice him into a fornication, and for her would have been an adulterous affair because she's married. So he flees the scene, but she tears his garment, and then when her husband comes home, she's got to cover up what happened. So she lies. Oh, he came in and tried to have his way with me and this and that and the other. So, you know, into the joint he goes. And eventually, of course, the baker and the butler are thrown in. And eventually he interprets dreams, makes his way to Pharaoh. But notice he kept his integrity. He did not cave in. He ran. He just got out of there. And sometimes when it comes to sin, that may be the only way to get out of the way of a sinful situation is to flee. I mean, turn around and run. Maybe literally run. Flee useful lust. Get as far away from them as you can. And for our young people, I mean, young people, we like to try things sometimes. We like to push the envelope. And that's how you learn. That's how you make mistakes. That's how you learn. But you got to be real careful if what you're doing is going to lead you into a sinful situation. Now, temptation itself is not the sin. You can't control a lot of things in our environment. We can't control the people around us. You never know. Someone comes in with the latest dirty joke. Maybe you have a problem with alcohol. And so someone comes in here, you want to take an M? I got this great bottle of Johnny Walker or whatever, scotch or vodka, whatever. Okay, now the temptation's there. Okay, you haven't sinned yet. No, thank you. I'm got to go over here and make copies here if you're at the office or if you're at a party. Hey, Fred, wait up. And, you know, you may have to just walk away, something like that, and just get away from it. And then here's another illustration from the movie Pirates of the Caribbean. I saw that movie when it came out. I can't remember why they're chasing him. Johnny Depp as Captain Jack Sparrow. But flee those things. Stay away from them. If you know, for instance, that alcohol is a temptation, then don't go to parties or anywhere where you know there's going to be alcohol, unless you've got someone you can take with you who can hold you accountable. If pornography, we've had explosions of pornography. Now we're getting to where you've got these moral degenerates who are wanting to use the term MAP, minor attracted person. That's adults. That's pedophiles, people who go to prison and are usually at the bottom of the food chain when they are in prison. They're trying to legitimize the sexual abuse of minors is what these people are doing. Get away from that. Stay away from porn. Stay away from whether it's adults or kids. Stay away from it. Okay. Get away from those things. Always try to be honest. And, you know, because if you tell the truth, you don't have to remember anything. Okay. Now you're going to be tempted to do these things, but that's not the sin. The sin is when you actually commit the act. And then one more here where Paul tells Timothy to avoid foolish and ignorant disputes, knowing that they generate strife. A servant of the Lord must not quarrel, but be gentle to all, able to teach and patient. This is the Calvin and Hobbes and Susie, the girl there, that they were always fussing and feuding. And, you know, if Bill Watterson, who created, and this is not authorized, I know this isn't, because he never authorized any merchandising for his characters. And if you read, I forget which one of his books, but he's got the reasoning behind that in one of the Calvin and Hobbes books. But this is this kind of thing. If you were to carry these two into their adult years, I have no doubt they're going to get married. They're fussing with each other as kids. I don't know how many couples I know who've been married for decades. And when they first met, one or both of them didn't like the other. Usually the woman didn't like the man for some reason. In fact, I know a couple, they've been married now probably about 50 years, maybe more than that. And when they first met, her dad asked her, "Oh, are you going to go out with Mark again?" And she said, "Oh, you mean El Creepo?" And she didn't care much for him. But like I said, they've been married for probably 50 years now at this point. And then fleeing useful lusts that Timothy encourages, or that Paul encourages Timothy to do, does not just refer to sexual lust. So we got to remember there are headstrong passions that young men have, and a lust is just really a strong desire for something. If you see your neighbor with your dream car, you know, that fully loaded Chevy Suburban, or maybe the Corvette or the collector's edition Thunderbird, and you're, "Oh yeah, man, I'd really like that." Okay, that you've got a strong desire, you're lusting, yeah. But we generally do think of it in a sexual context. And so there are things we can lust at, money. You know, who wouldn't like to make more money? I think, you know, even Bill Gates would probably use a few extra bucks every now and then. But the idea that that's all I'm pursuing, that's all I care is money, then we got to watch that. That can get out of control. And then one last thing, verse 19, they went out from us, showing that they were not of us. John is dealing with some false teachers here. He hasn't specifically identified any false teacher, but he indicates that they have been with them. The false teachers have been with them. So it would appear that they went out from us. They had one time been Christians, but they may not have been deeply converted. And there are some people, I believe, that they get baptized and they're just getting wet. "Oh, I'm dating this girl and she won't go out with me, or she won't marry me, or whatever, unless I'm a Christian. Okay, yeah, so I'll be baptized." I was in a jail ministry once. And the guy I was working with, we had some people in one of the cell blocks that wanted to be baptized. And we had a bunch of some of the women from the women's block here around this big conference table. And in fact, it was some women in the other women's block that wanted to be baptized. And he said, "Oh, well, so-and-so is going to be baptized. Is there anyone else that wants to be?" "Oh, yeah, I'll be baptized. I'll be baptized." And they went around the table. And we baptized 50, I think it was 57 people the next day. And I said, "Wait a minute, let's talk about that." In fact, one of them went back and brought a cellmate back, and she said, we had this kind of large, like, portable bathtub, basically, and she sat in it, and he kind of talked to her a little bit and then baptized her. I said, "Wait a minute. Do these women," and there were some men, we baptized a lot of men that day too, "do they know what they're doing?" "Oh, yeah, it's fine. It's good." He was looking for numbers is what he was looking for. He wasn't looking for real converts. I don't know, maybe it took on some of them, but my hunch, my gut feeling is we had 57 people and the vast majority of them just got wet. And so we have to remember, not everybody who is baptized is honestly converted, but my job or your job as a Christian, honestly teach them as best you can. And then what their mindset is, that's on them. That's between them and God at that point. Paul warned of departures when he said the Spirit clearly says that in latter times some will abandon the faith. They were already abandoning the faith back then. And follow deceiving spirits, the things taught by demons. Such teachings come through hypocritical liars, those who con sciences have been, whose consciousness, somehow that word got split up, whose consciousness, whose conscience, I'll get it, just hang on, have been seared with a hot iron. And then he goes into what some of the false teaching. That's 1 Timothy 4, verse 1. So there are false teachers. It does matter what we believe, or he wouldn't be warning them to beware of false teachers. John or Paul would be doing that. But John seems to be here separating the faithful Christians from those who went away. They're going away show that none of them belong to us. And there comes a time when false teaching begins to get promoted in the church. And false teachers are not going to walk in the front door and say, "Hi there, I'm a false teacher, and I'm here to cause chaos, split the church, and lead everybody to hell." That's not how they operate. They typically come in under the radar. You'll think they're faithful, and then they'll have enough truth so that you accept them into fellowship, and then they'll start probably by asking questions. It's okay to ask questions, but you know, be careful with questions and answers, so that they will start teaching things and saying things. You're going to think, "Well, man, that sounds a little weird. Maybe I need to ask him about that." And then by the time if they are figured out, you figure out who they are, many times you're already up to your eyeballs in trouble. So just be careful when it comes to these false teachers. And when you do come across a false teacher, we know from other scriptures, the idea is you need to disassociate with them, study with them, admonish them. And if they're not going to accept the truth, then you need to withdraw fellowship, or as most churches would say, excommunicate them. Or in plain English, you need to kick them out. We can't have false teaching coming in and splitting the church. We can't have it because they will go after the younger Christians, the weaker Christians. Younger Christians are not necessarily the weaker ones. They may be not as knowledgeable, but I know Christians that have been there for decades. They barely know the plan of salvation. Okay, so that is going to wrap it up for today. Maybe went a little longer than we normally do. But for Thursday, let's pray for the nation. How good timing. I guess apropos is the right word, being the 4th of July and our Independence Day. And let's include our elected officials, the election coming up. Who knows what's going to happen? I still believe that at least one, if not both, Trump and Biden are going to be off their respective tickets before November comes around. I think it's November 5th is Election Day, but we'll see. So let's go to God in prayer. And no, I'm not making that a prophetic in Jesus' name statement. No, that's just my opinion. Just kind of looking things over from where I sit. That's just an opinion, okay? Just understand. That's no prophecy there, just an opinion. Let's pray. Thank you, Lord, for another day, and we thank you for another year of freedom and independence that we enjoy as Americans. We want to pray for our nation, Lord, and whatever happens in November, just pray for a peaceful transition of power in January, that losers will accept the results, and that winners will be gracious as well. And we want to pray for the elected officials, from the president all the way down to our mayors and city councils, our Congress and our courts. We pray for godly decisions, decisions, Lord, that can help our nation to see the revival that it needs, for the truth of your word to be spread to others, so people will know there's a God in heaven and Jesus is the way to get to you. Thank you for Jesus. Thank you for the forgiveness of sins. We pray for forgiveness. And help us, Lord, to always walk in your light. In Jesus' name, amen. So that's going to wrap it up for today. Hope you have a great 4th of July. And if you got any questions, you can send them to me at 2timothy4.2.3@gmail.com. You may leave them in the comment section below if you like. Comment on these videos, like these videos. Give it a thumbs up if you like it. That helps it get into the circulation, I think, around social media. Thanks for watching. We will see you in the next video. And even though it is 4th of July, you know, we still can't forget about coffee time, right? Yeah.